Good morning. We wish to welcome all to Holy Cross. And to those of you who may be visiting, we invite you to join in our Eucharistic celebration today and to celebrate God's presence in our lives. Matthew continues the Sermon on the Mount with three-part introduction by Jesus on the way in the kingdom of heaven. Today's reading is part one and deals with the law. Part two deals with worship and religious practice and contains the Lord's Prayer. Part three deals with trusting God and deeds of loving service to our neighbor. The celebrant of this Mass is Father Reif. Please join in our entrance hymn 967, Forgive Our Sins.
Good morning, everyone. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you. Our entrance hymn leads us very naturally into our penitential rite. As we do ask God to forgive our sins, we take a moment to reflect upon those sins as we put them in perspective with our whole life. As we repent now and ask God's forgiveness and mercy. You came as Lord and Redeemer. Lord, have mercy. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Christ, have mercy. Your kingdom is for all generations. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Bye. let us pray. O God, who teach us that you abide in hearts that are just and true, grant that we may be so fashioned by your grace as to become a dwelling pleasing to you, through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Sirach. If you choose, you can keep the commandments. They will save you. If you trust in God, you too shall live. He has set before you fire and water. To whichever you choose, stretch forth your hand. Before man are life and death, good and evil. Whichever he chooses shall be given him. Immense in the wisdom of the Lord. He is mighty in power and all-seeing. The eyes of God are on those who fear him. He understands man's every deed. No one does he command to act unjustly. To none does he give license to sin. The word of the Lord.
Blessed are they who follow the law of the Lord. Blessed are they who follow the law of the Lord. Blessed are they whose way is blameless, who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are they who observe his decrees, who seek him with all their heart. Blessed are they who follow the law of the commanded that your precepts be diligently kept. Oh, that I might be firm in the ways of keeping your statutes. Blessed are they who follow the law of the Lord. Be good to your servant, that I may live and keep your words. Open my eyes, that I may consider the wonders of your law. Blessed are they who follow the law of the Lord. Instruct me, O Lord, in the way of your statutes, that I may exactly observe them. Give me discernment that I may observe your law and keep it with all my heart. Blessed are they who follow the law of the Lord.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, we speak a wisdom to those who are mature, not a wisdom of this age, nor of the rules of this age who are passing away. Rather, we speak God's wisdom, mysterious, hidden, which God predetermined before the ages of our glory, and which none of the rulers of this age knew. For if they had known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, what eye has not seen, and ear has not heard, and what has not entered the human heart, what God has prepared for those who love him, this God has revealed to us through the Spirit. For the Spirit scrutinizes everything, even the depths of God. The word of the Lord.
Alleluia, 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 alleluia. Blessed are you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, you have revealed to little ones the mysteries of the kingdom. Alleluia, alleluia.
Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. And Jesus said to his disciples, Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. Amen, I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not the smallest letter or the smallest part of a letter will pass from the law until all things have taken place. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do so will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever obeys and teaches these commandments will be called greatest in the kingdom of heaven. I tell you, unless your righteousness surpasses that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. You have heard that it was said to your ancestors, you shall not kill, and whoever kills will be liable to judgment. But I say to you, whoever is angry with his brother will be liable to judgment. And whoever says to his brother, Raca, will be answerable to the Sanhedrin. And whoever says, you fool, will be liable to fiery Gehenna. Therefore, if you bring your gift to the altar, and there recall that your brother has anything against you, leave your gift aside, go first and be reconciled with your brother, and then come and offer your gift. Settle with your opponent quickly while on the way to court. Otherwise, your opponent will hand you over to the judge, and the judge will hand you over to the guard, and you will be thrown into prison. Amen, I say to you, you will not be released until you have paid the last penny. You have heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you, everyone who looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than to have your whole body thrown into Gehenna. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than to have your whole body go into Gehenna. It was also said, whoever divorces his wife must give her a bill of divorce. But I say to you, whoever divorces his wife, unless the marriage is unlawful, causes her to commit adultery, and whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Again, you have heard that it was said to your ancestors, do not take a false oath, but make good to the Lord all that you vow. But I say to you, do not swear at all, not by heaven, for it is God's throne, not by the earth, for it is his footstool, not by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. Do not swear by your head, for you cannot make a single hair white or black. Let your yes mean yes, and your no mean no. Anything more is from the evil one. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. These words today in our gospel bring to light a certain sternness in Jesus that we sometimes don't see or hear. The earlier readings are a wonderful help to us as we strive to do what the gospel demands. The second reading that Nina read is from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians, where he says, we speak a wisdom to those who are mature, not a wisdom of this age, nor of the rulers of this age who are passing away. Rather, we speak God's wisdom, mysterious, hidden, which God predetermined before the ages for our glory, in which none of the rulers of this age knew. Think of that for a bit, and go back for a moment in your own mind to the beautiful responsorial psalm that our choir offered for us. Blessed are they who follow the law of the Lord. That is an echo of 2 weeks ago here when Father George brought out the idea that blessed means happy. And so the overall balanced picture of real, genuine Christianity has to do with the happiness, the exquisite happiness that comes with following Jesus. If we were to base all of our thoughts about Jesus simply on today's gospel, we might be led astray a little bit. We might forget that he used hyperbole, and that to deliberately maim one's body by pulling out an eye or cutting off a hand, that is a terrible sin. And Jesus is not recommending that we commit sin. He's trying to keep us away from that. He brings to bear in today's gospel a series of things about the commandments that he, Jesus, was able to put into the perspective of the great ideal that he calls for. You've heard it said to the ancients, but I say to you. You've heard it said to the people of olden times, but what I say is, what he said is the perfection which people, which no one is able to follow completely. But at the same time, he, Jesus, has the right to offer to us the ideal. And if some might be a bit uncomfortable with what seems like an extreme harshness, pay very special attention to one of the petitions in the prayer of the faithful today, and let that petition help you if you are a bit worried, a bit nervous, or whatever, about these ideals that Jesus puts before us. And as we do all this, I'd like to draw out the fact that today is the birthday of the awesome Abraham Lincoln. Lincoln was not a preacher. He was not an evangelist. He was simply an awesome Christian. He, in the little family that they were in Kentucky and later in Illinois, he had exposure to one book only, the Bible. That's all that the family owned by way of reading material. But devout families everywhere, both Catholic and other Christian types, would have the Bible. He, like others, in the light of day, was able to read that very carefully. But he was so enraptured by what the Bible had to say that even at night, by the light of a candle, he would read what otherwise would have been impossible without the candle. One of his biographers, Doris Kearns Goodwin, in the wonderful book that she wrote a few years ago, Team of Rivals, describing the cabinet members, each one deliberately chosen by Lincoln because that cabinet member wasn't just a yes man. They didn't agree with each other very often, but he wanted a good kind of disagreement to characterize their cabinet meetings. One of his cabinet members happened to be a Mr. Seward of Auburn, New York, who purchased Alaska from Russia. Kind of a good deal in anyone's accounting book. But Lincoln was, along with being growing up through the stages of being a politician, locally here, locally there, studying law, because in his early adulthood, he was able to read the law, and he became a lawyer. But Doris Kearns Goodwin says that he is the greatest statesman in 3,000 years. Going back to some of those awesome names who lived several hundred years before Christ, those people, some of whom were tyrants as Roman emperors, yes, but others of whom were anything but tyrants, people of great wisdom. Lincoln was not a saint, but he was able to bring to bear upon this country and in some indirect ways upon other countries in the world, he was able to bring to bear the awesome truth that slavery is nothing more than institutionalized immorality. Slavery was horrendously terrible. And many of the religious leaders of that day simply turned aside or turned a blind eye to the fact that it was so horrible. Among those who stood out as people of real honor were the Quakers. They knew how terrible slavery was. But the institutional religions, in many instances, turned a blind eye. And Lincoln, not only with the act of freeing the slaves, but his insistence upon the 13th Amendment, brought to bear upon the consciousness of a whole nation what is good and what is evil. To visit the shrine of Lincoln in Washington is an awesome event. So let's keep in mind, as we think of our divine Lord as offering us wonderful examples of what we need to do, and at the same time offers us through the other portions of Scripture a balance in looking at the whole picture. And if we keep in mind St. Paul's words to the Corinthians, where he says, we speak a wisdom to those who are mature, not a wisdom of this age, nor of the rulers of this age who are passing away. Rather, we speak God's wisdom, mysterious, hidden, which God predetermined before the ages for our glory, and which none of the rulers of this age even knew. There we have it. St. Paul was able to take what Jesus had said and put it into a context that helps us to understand that Jesus didn't just simply issue demands, but he put ideals before us. And if we pay real attention to one of the petitions in today's prayer of the faithful, we can see that or hear that coming through. Do pay attention to those prayers of the faithful and see if you can hear toward the later portion of them something that speaks to what Jesus was talking about in today's gospel. Please stand for the creed. What do we believe? I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. The Spirit was incarnate from the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day.
ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Transitioning from the recitation of the Creed and all of its doctrinal truth, we now go to the prayer of the faithful as we offer those prayers to an all-loving God.
For Pope Francis, Bishop Metano, and all of our priests and deacons, that they may lead in faith and serve, and I love the flock entrusted to their case by Christ, the Good Shepherd. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That people of the world strengthen their relationships with one another, building a world of justice and peace. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are suffering from storms, cold, and other natural disasters, that God will give them strength, renew their spirits, and help them find the resources which they need. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For truth, honesty, morality in our homes and at work, in our schools, government, and church, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
On this World Marriage Day, that engaged and married, marriages in distress, the separated, the divorced, and the widowed may find peace, happiness, and comfort, knowing that God is always with them. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all who are sick or suffering in any way, that they may be strengthened by the healing presence of Jesus. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For everlasting light and peace for those who have died, especially Marion Northrup and David Baker, and for Michael Bennett Jr., for whom this Mass is being offered, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pause for a moment and make our own private petitions. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Father of us all, we thank you for the role models that have been put before us throughout history. Help us to strive to imitate them, but above all, to be living proof that Jesus is Lord forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
The second collection today is for the Catholic Courier Journal. And please join in our offertory hymn, 399, in the green hymnal, Deep Within.
Thank you.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father. May this offering, O Lord, we pray, cleanse and renew us, and may it become for those who do your will the source of eternal reward through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For by his birth he brought renewal to humanity's fallen state, and by his suffering he canceled out our sins. By his rising from the dead he has opened the way to eternal life, and by ascending to you, Father, he has unlocked the gates of heaven. And so, with the company of angels and saints, we sing the hymn of your praise, as without end we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more, giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity. Together with Francis, our Pope, and Salvatore, our Bishop, and all the clergy, religious, laity, yourselves, loved ones here, all those that we pray for among the living. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Saint Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope in the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other a sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
would any minister of communion who plans to take the Eucharist to a sick or shut-in person please come up to the sanctuary? Let us pray. Having fed upon these heavenly delights, we pray, O Lord, that we may always long for that food by which we truly live, through Christ our Lord.
CMA is doing great. We have reached 98.35% of our goal. Thank you to the generous 464 households. We are looking for 30 more households to pledge $50 to reach our goal. If you have not yet given, there is still opportunity. Seniors and friends will be meeting Thursday, February 16th in the Parish Center from 1:30 to 3:30. Holy Cross Annual Women's Eve of Reflection will be Thursday, February 16th at 7 o'clock p.m. in the Parish Center. Our presenter will be Kathy Kemp, Pastoral Associate from St. Joseph's in Penfield. Teens will be in high school in fall 2017. Reminder to check out what National Catholic Youth Conference is all about. There's an information meeting February 12th at 2:15 in the Parish Center. Save the date, March 4th, for the celebration of the green. Please see our bulletin, our website, for full details on all events happening in our parish community. And there will be a coffee hour after Mass today in the Parish Center. Please join in our recessional hymn 720, The Kingdom of God.
The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. This Mass is ended. Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord and proclaim the gospel. Thanks be to God.